have no sense of knowing that God has closed that door, you're going to be ramming into it.
I thank God that the story of the cross is not just for sinners. The story of the cross is for saints.
We are so delighted to bring God's word this morning. We are reading from Isaiah chapter number 46. Isaiah chapter number 46, verse 9, verse 10, and verse 11. Then we'll go to chapter number 40, verse 8. Then we'll go to Romans chapter number 4, verse 20. This is the word of the Lord. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, my purpose shall stand. I will do all my pleasure, calling a bird of prey from the east, the man that executes my counsel from a far country. Yes, I have spoken it. I also bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I also do it. Chapter 40 of Isaiah. Just to echo our theme verse for this series, verse 8. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Romans chapter number 4. Romans chapter number 4, verse 20. This is speaking of Abraham. He says, he staggered not, he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. He did not waver in unbelief about the promise of God, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he, God, had promised, he was able also to perform. Let's read from Sarah's perspective. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 11. This is Sarah's perspective. Through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age. Why? Because she judged him faithful who had promised. By faith, even though Sarah herself was barren and she was too old, she received the ability to procreate, because she regarded the one who had given the promise to be trustworthy. Our Father and our Master, we are so thankful this morning Thank you for the reading of your word. We pray, may you speak to us, may you minister. We ask, O God, because of your word, may you change the course of our lives. May you transform us. May you impact us. May you do a new thing in our lives as we interact with your word. We honor you, we bless you. Thank you. Now, Father, we pray that which we have meditated on throughout this past week and many days before. Lord, I pray, let that which is in my mouth be acceptable before you. May it bring meaning into the hearts, into the lives of your people. Let that be transformation. We honor you, we bless you, in Jesus' name. As every saint say, amen. Thank you. May take your seats in the presence of the Lord. 2 weeks ago, by the grace of the Lord, we began a series which is entitled The Forever Word of God. The Forever Word of God. Using Isaiah chapter 40 verse 8, which says the grass may wither, the flowers may fade, but the word of the Lord stands forever. It is settled. It is done. That which it speaks is already done. And that's a series that we are dealing with in this season of our time. 2 weeks ago in the second service, we brought the word that we had called the creative power for acceleration. The creative power for acceleration. Last week, Dr. Andrew brought the word on the permanence of God and the permanence of the word of God. And today, by God's grace, we bring the message we've entitled, My Purpose Shall Stand. I've taken that phrase from our verses today, from Isaiah chapter number 40, verse number 9, 10, and 11. Let me read that text once again, now from NIV, and this is what the Lord says. Remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say, my purpose shall stand, and I'll do all that I please. From the east, I summon a bird of prey. From far off land, a man to fulfill my purpose. What I have said, that I will bring about. What I have planned, that I will do. That's the text we are using today. The recurrent thoughts I want to build from the last two messages and then build the sermon for today. The recurrent thought that we began with is this one. Every act of God is through His word. The acceleration of our lives, the acceleration of our projects, and everything that concerns us is contingent on the power of the word of God. Every act of God is through His word. God has determined to do things He has already revealed in His word. Every act of God is through His word. Whatever He is going to do for you, He has already revealed in His word. Whatever He is going to accomplish for you, He has already revealed in His word. Every act of God is through His word. So the acceleration of our lives is locked in the scriptures, right in the pages of the Bible you hold. The acceleration of our projects and everything that concerns us is in the Bible. It is contingent, it is dependent on the power of the Word of God. And today's recurrent word is, I am God, there is no other. My purpose shall stand. I am God, there is no other. My purpose shall stand. The scripture we've read this morning refers to a very mysterious situation in the times of Judah. Judah ransacked, totally destroyed, and taken into exile by Nebuchadnezzar. 586 BC. Everything destroyed. The temple that was the center of their economy, of their worship, totally destroyed. Everything removed, including the goblets, the tumblers, the vessels of honor that were used in the temple, totally taken by Nebuchadnezzar. As if that was not enough, he even took the king. You remember once last year I talked about it? Nebuchadnezzar had a hobby of removing the eyes of the vanquished queen, the kings. So Zedekiah had his eyes pulled out. And he was taken. And Zedekiah was not the only king that he had taken to Babylon. He had a hobby of collecting vanquished kings. He kept kings in his home, in his palace, and he would use them as a spectacle. But they were blind. From various nations, he would bring them to Babylon, blind kings, and he would taunt them. But you have also to remember that there was a remnant that remained. And part of the remnant that remained included the prophet Jeremiah. And the governor that was set there was Gedaliah. Gedaliah was allowed to stay with a small group of people so that they can take care of the city. City that is in rubbles, in ruins. And Jeremiah once wrote a letter to the people that had gone to exile. 2 years ago, Dr. Mkwaela preached a sermon out of that letter. In that letter, Jeremiah writes and says, settle. Have your children get married, for you are going to stay there for a long time. Actually, 70 years you are going to be there. And pray for the prosperity of that city. For when the city prospers, you will also prosper. So he said, settle. Now, after 70 years had passed, the children of Israel knew, the children of Judah knew, God is supposed to take us back after 70 years. If you remember, if you've read Daniel, he comes to God to pray after 70 years. Daniel is in Babylon as a prophet. After 70 years, he comes to the Lord and he starts praying. And he says, God, the 70 years that you had allotted to us is now finished. What are you going to do for us? Are you sending us back to Babylon? And God does mysterious things. And he says, yes, I'm going to send you. But you know what he does? He sends a person who is not a believer to rescue them. He sends another king from Persia called Cyrus. And that king comes and destroys Babylon. And when they destroy Babylon, they released the children of Israel, the children of God who has been there for 70 years. And Cyrus does something that is strange. He goes into the treasury of his kingdom. He gives them money and says, go back to your land. Cyrus had a different philosophy from Nebuchadnezzar. His philosophy was, I'm going to honor every God. And I'm going to allow every God to have their own place of worship. So I'm going to release the children of Judah. Let them go to their land. And peradventure, their God will protect me. That was Cyrus. Now that is the Cyrus you find in verse 11 of Isaiah chapter 46. He says, I am going to send a ravenous bird of prey. I'm going to command a person from the east. That person is Cyrus. That's the background of this text. That mysteriously, I purposed a long time ago that I am going to bring back my children, and I'm going to use Cyrus to release my children to go back to their land. Interesting. I was reading out of the Charisma magazine last week, and there is a caption that is very strange. They are asking the question, is Donald Trump the Cyrus of today? Those are Christians. They do not know what is happening, because the conservative born again candidate has been beaten by Donald Trump so much. Ted Cruz, who is born again, very evangelical, he cannot match with Donald Trump. So the question has been, will God use Donald Trump to reverse everything Obama has done? Is Donald Trump the Cyrus of today? I do not know. I'm not an American. I do not know how to answer that question. But what you find here is that God purposed years back. He said, when I scatter my children to the four corners of the earth and they repent, they confess, they come back to me, I am going to draw them back. That is his purpose. So God says, I stand over my purpose. It shall be done. Whatsoever I've spoken, it shall be done. I am God. There is no one like me. Whatever I have spoken, it shall come to pass. That is the background to the text we've read. So based on the revealed word of God from the past and from the past 2 weeks, we established that the word of God is an embodiment of God's thoughts, creative power of God, and the will of God. The word of God, the scriptures, are the creative thoughts, are the very thoughts of God, the creative power of God. In the scriptures, in the word of God, you find the will of God. In the word of God, you find the will of God. You find what his plans are for you. What are the plans for the universe? What is your place in the universe? In this word of God, you will come to realize that everything is temporal. Everything is temporal except God himself. Except God himself. And the word, which is his own representation. Jesus Christ said, heavens and earth shall pass away, but not even one iota, one dot. Iota is a Greek word for a dot. One iota shall pass away from the word of God. Nothing shall pass away from the word of God. The word of God is forever settled. Is forever settled. And 2 weeks ago, this is what we had established. We had established that the word of God is the creative word. The word of God creates. When you speak, when you declare based on the word of God, it is the creative word of God. The word of God has the power to sustain creation. That's got the power to sustain creation. And the Bible in Colossians says that Jesus Christ holds all things together. Everything together. And you have to remember, in John chapter number 1, verse 1, the Bible is very clear. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, the Word became flesh. So Jesus is the embodiment of the word of God. Jesus is God himself. And the Bible says he holds all things together. He holds all things together. He sustains everything. The word of God has a power to impart life. And this word releases grace, releases power, releases revelation, by which believers grow in faith and their commitment to Jesus. It releases insight for you, for your growth, for my growth. This word of God, this word of God is a sword with which we fight with. We fight with the word against the enemy, against demonic powers, against unbelief. We use the word against all that which stands against us. And by the way, this word of God, when you read it consistently, constantly, it judges you. It brings discernment. It distinguishes issues in your life. It makes you to come to realize that there are some things inside of you that needs to be disposed of. There are some things that needs to be removed. When you spend time in the word of God, you constantly grow into purity. The word of God. So it's powerful. So when you talk about the forever word of God, it's important for us to understand it. Now, we have a challenge these days. In the modern world, everything now is being ruled by the phone. The phone. Some of you, you decided to use the mobile phone or an iPad to come with it to the church so that you can read the Bible with it. But the challenge is that on that phone, there's Facebook. So while in the church, you may be tempted to go on Facebook. On this, there is Instagram. You take a photo and immediately, bam, Instagram, it goes. On this, there is WhatsApp. WhatsApp has changed how we do communication. Oh, there is WhatsApp on here. And some of us, we think it is easier just to come with one. Instead of coming with a Bible, with a phone, with an iPad, it's too much. Why don't I just get one mobile device? But the challenge is that we attempted. There's chit chat here. There is Twitter here. What else? What else? What else? You know all these various social media platforms. The temptation is that while you are in the church, you may be tempted to be reading what your friend from Ukraine is sending you. And you forget that you are in the presence of the Lord and God is speaking to you. God is delivering to you the forever word of God. He is delivering that which you need to hear. Temptation. Some of us will say, no, the U version that is here, you know, U version is a free version of the Bible. U version that is here, that's what I'm going to be using for my study. I'll be honest with you, it is very hard to study the Bible using an iPad or using your tab. You know, it's just difficult just to underline and to color and to come back to it. It is nice, but not very nice. It makes me look sophisticated, but I'll be honest with you, I may be backward if I continue using the tab for the study of the word. So I would rather challenge you that for the study of your word, go use the hardcover. Traditional. For the study of your word, if you are going to be waking up every morning at 4 o'clock, I suggest to you, you go back to the old traditional Bible. This is good to color. This is good, you know, just to go back to write on the side. You will be surprised that you remember things when you color, when you write on the side. You can be able to go back. Yes, you can have some young people are so savvy, they can be able to go back. Maybe there's some young people we can forgive them or we can allow them. But the older people, it's you will backslide. I challenge you to spend time in the Word of God. Spend time, enjoy it, because it shall be able to transform your life, change everything about you. Two thoughts. In your notes I said three thoughts, but really there are two thoughts and three implications. Two thoughts out of this text, two theological statements that gives us the confidence in the word of the Lord. We have two thoughts in this text that gives us the confidence in the word of God. Number one, the unique, matchless God. The unique, matchless God. This is what the Bible says in Isaiah. If you turn back to Isaiah chapter 40, you will see how Isaiah shows this God who is unique. Verse number 10. Isaiah chapter 46. Verse number 9, sorry. It says, remember the former things of old, for I am God. There is no one else. I am God, and there is none like me. I am the only one on the list. No one else is number 2. No one else is number 10. No one else is number 1,000. I am the only one on the list. That list of God, there is only God. He says, there is no one like me. This God, who is unique, who is matchless, he gives his word. Therefore, we can depend on his word. We can depend on his word. He is unique, he is matchless. There is no one like me. He can't be compared to other gods. So you will find in the book of Isaiah, one theme that he takes Isaiah, Dr. Mkwaila referred to this last week, is that he taunts, he mocks idols, graven idols. How people go to length to make idols. The person goes and cuts a tree and sculptures it. Then he pays homage to it and he says, you are my God. He says, you are the one who made it. How do you pay homage to it again? How can you bow down to an idol and declare it to be God? How can you look into a tree in the bush and declare it is God? No, he is God. He cannot be compared to any. He is like no other. Because of his uniqueness, he gives quality to his word. Because of his uniqueness, he gives quality to his word. He says, I make known the end from the beginning. I tell you the future at the very beginning. I declare to you, I prophesy to you, I always am able to tell you the end of the story even before it begins. He knows it all. He is eternal. Because of his quality, because of who he is, when he speaks things into being, they are permanent. He says he is God. So because of who he is, we can trust what he says. He's not an idol. He's not Hare Krishna. He's not Muhammad. He is not any other gods. He is God. Yahweh. The self-existing one. Yahweh. And he says, I know all things. To him, everything is in the present. Everything is in the now. He has no time. Yes, when he created the heavens and the earth, when he spoke the universe into being, he began time for you and for me. But he is not constrained by time. Time is for humanity. It's not for God. God knows all things at once. In eternity past and in eternity future, he knows all things at once. And when he speaks as God. So we can depend on his word. He has the knowledge of things before they happen. He is a forever present God. So he can be able to speak about your future. He can be able to prophesy things into your life. So this is one thing you find in this text, that he is unique, he is matchless, he is incomparable. There is no one like him. Because of his uniqueness, the word that he speaks is unique. It is inspired. It is inspired. The word has quality. The word of God. It is inspired. Everything that it speaks about, the scriptures, is factual, is truthful. It is inspired. The second thing that gives us confidence, another confidence builder, is the immutability of God. The immutability of God. That word, younger people, they will easily know when I say the mutant. You know a mutant? A mutant is something that changes. So you put in at the beginning something that does not change. A mutant in science fiction movies is somebody or something that changes, keeps on changing. But God does not change. Now, a mutant is not dependable. You may be sitting to somebody next to you. You think it's a woman, but it's a man. It's a mutant. So you can tell I watch movies. Mutants. But God is not a mutant. He's immutable. He is dependable. He does not change. Because he does not change, his word also does not change. The word that he has spoken does not change. Imagine if God was to change. Today you come to him, he's happy. Tomorrow he's angry. He's a mutant. Our God is not a mutant. He is immutable. In Malachi chapter 3 verse 6 he says, "For I am the Lord, I do not change. Therefore you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob." If I was a changing God, I would have done away with you. I promise that I'm not going to destroy you. Therefore, I'm God, I do not change. I'll stand on my word. I stand on my promise. God is not a mutant. I am glad God does not change. I'm honest with you. If we had a mutant, capricious God, that would have been dangerous. We would not know what to do every time. Every time you do things that are dangerous. Today you find him, he is Mr. Angry God. Tomorrow you find him, he is Mrs. Jealous God. Mutant. But that's not our God. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is eternally the same. That's our God. So I place the question in there. If the Bible is an inspired word of God, would it truly be trustworthy if God's character was changeable and as a result unreliable? Here you depend upon the word of God, but the God who wrote it is every time changing. You can't depend upon that word. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this God is unchangeable. This God's word is unchangeable. You can rely on it. You can depend on it. Hebrews chapter number 6, verse 17 and verse 10 says there are two things that God cannot change. Number one, he cannot change his promises. Number two, he cannot change his oaths or his vows. Oh, hallelujah. He cannot change his promises. He cannot change his vows. Whatever he's vowed, he will not change. Whatever he has promised, he will not change. He says there are two things God cannot lie. Maybe let's read that text. Hebrews, verse 17. Wherein God willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of the promise the immutability of his counsel. I'm reading from King James Version. Confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for the refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Two things that God cannot change. Two immutable things. Impossible for God to lie. When he promises, it's done. When he makes an oath, it is done. You can go to sleep banking on it. Wow. Two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie. Very strong words. Two unchangeable things that it is totally impossible for God to lie. His promises and his oaths. So brothers and sisters, this forever word of God is a word of God that is powerful. We can depend upon it. As we go through this series, I challenge you never to let go of the word of God, because your acceleration depends upon you engaging the word of God. Your change, the transformation that you need, depends upon you engaging with the word of God. The word of God will bring change in your life. The word of God will bring change in the situations of your life. The word of God. This forever word of God. Quickly, I want to share with you three implications. Number one, God is completely trustworthy. His word, which is a representation of his nature, is equally trustworthy. God is completely trustworthy. You can trust him. That's why we come every Sunday to hear the word of the Lord, because God is trustworthy. He is dependable. And therefore the word that he has given is dependable also. We can trust it. The scriptures cannot be compared to other writings in quality and the reliability and inspiration. There are many other holy writings by other religions. They cannot be compared to in quality, in reliability and inspiration. You cannot compare the Bible to other writings. The Bible, over the years, it has been found to be true. Its prophetic utterings have been found to be true, trustworthy. Its quality is uncompared to others. So I challenge you to fall in love with the word of God. Fall in love with the word of God. Read it. Read it every day of your life. Store it into your spirit. It is out of that word that your acceleration will come from. It is out of that word. So question, how much of the word do you read? How much of this word do you read? The Bible says for Sarah, she trusted the Lord. She continued to trust the Lord. Why? Because God was faithful. She found him trustworthy. He says, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age. Why? Because she judged him faithful who promised. I do not know what you are going through. I submit to you, the God you trust, he is faithful. The God was promised a breakthrough from you, for you. He is faithful. He is reliable. Sarah, the Bible says, even when she had no strength, but she received strength to conceive. Even if when she was past the age of conceiving, even when she was not experiencing what other women experiences, she was able to experience a miracle. Why? Because she judged the one who gave her the promise as faithful, as reliable. Your God is reliable. What has he taught you? He is a reliable God. Don't move away from the word of God. Whatever he has promised, it shall pass. It shall come true. He is a reliable God. Trust him. Trust him. Malawi, trust God. ICA, trust God. He is dependable. He is trustworthy. He is reliable. Has he promised you something? It shall come to pass. Has he promised you a child? It shall come to pass. Has he promised you a husband? It shall come to pass. He is reliable. Hold on to the word of God. He is reliable. She knew everything within her was as good as dead. But he who promised is reliable. Everything within her had gone south. But he who had promised was reliable. That's God. That is our God. He is reliable. Number two, when you live according to his purpose, according to his will, as revealed in the word, everything related to it is possible. When you live according to his purpose, that is according to his will that is written in the scriptures, everything related to it, it is possible. So the question that I pose before you, are you living according to the will of God? Are you living according to his purpose? The unfortunate thing in today's Christianity is that we want the gift without following what the giver wants us to do. We want the results without staying in the word, in the will of God. So we have made the church like it's a circus place where a magician comes and he draws something and he throws it to you. He draws it out of his jacket and he throws it to you. He gets a nice handkerchief here and he does this, a dove comes and he throws it to you. And everyone cheers, hey, man of God, hey, prophet. But we do not want to stay in the word. We do not want to stay in the will of the Lord, of the word of God. Like I've said it before, that is magic. That's not Christianity. It is not found in the scriptures. That is found in false religion. That is never in the scriptures. God says, when you see those prophets, run away from them. Stay in the word. find the will of the Lord. Are you living according to the purposes of God? Either I've given two purposes of God. One, that some people have got the sovereign will of God or the decreed will of God. These are things that will happen whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not, you will die if Jesus Christ does not break the skyline. That is the will of God. Whether you like it or not, there will be summer and there will be winter. Those are decreed with a will of God. They are done. God has made them and they will continue to be. That is the will of God. But there's also wills of God written in the scriptures that he commands us to do. He commands us to do. When you read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3, he says, this is the will of God for you, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality. So this is a specific instance where the will of God is commanded of you, that you have to obey. This is the will of God for you. You live pure lives. You run away from sexual immorality. This is the will of God. Question, are you living in the will of God? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 18. He says, give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. He says, every time, have a life that gives thanks to the Lord. And he says, that's the will of God. So, Malawi, let me ask, are we living in the will of God? If every time we are the most that complain. No, Pastor, things are not moving well. So we have to say it. That's the truth. No. There's a difference between the truth you are speaking and the truth of the word. If you are going to live by the truth of the word, then you have to tame your tongue. You have to change what you speak. Because some of the things you are going to speak, even if you call them truth, it will be unbelief. You remember the scripture, the Bible says, 12 people went into the promised land to go and survey. 12 people were sent by Moses to go survey the promised land, to go spy the promised land. When they came back with facts. But do you know what God said? It was a source of unbelief. Facts will be a source of unbelief to us. Oh, we found giants there. Fact. Oh, we found they were so big. Fact. Oh, we found grapes there. Fact. They were very big. You know, the way they describe them, it says when you eat them, they would leak of fluids like blood. That's how they describe them. Very big grapes. Fact. Everything was factual. Actually, when we looked at them, we looked like grasshoppers. Now it's moving away from fact. They even did something that was weird. Is actually, in the eyes of the giants, we looked like grasshoppers. And I scratched my eyes. I said, so you went and you sat with the giants and you asked them a question and said, how do I look in your eyes? Did you have a chat with the giants and ask them questions how you look like in their eyes? It was factual. But when they brought those facts, how did the people of God react? Mawe, we can't go in that land. We are going to be eaten by the giants. Every one of them went by the tent and sat down and started crying. And started saying, Moses, not us. We are not going to the promised land. Fact brought unbelief. So we may be thinking we are talking about facts every time in Malawi. When we talk about how bad we are. When we talk about everything. And yet we are moving away from faith. It's time we started speaking the word of faith. It's time we started declaring the purposes of God over this country. It's time we declare the purpose of God over our families. Our families are not going to the dogs. They are going to be pure. They are going to grow stronger. Our economy is going to grow stronger in the name of Jesus. We have to declare the word of the Lord. Yes, we know things are not good, but God would want to declare something good over our lives. So turn to your neighbor and tell them, turn that fact into faith. Come on. Turn that fact into faith. It's important for us to understand this. Now you see in there that the will of God is tied to his purpose. He says his purpose, when he declares it, it is done. Remember, verse 9, the former things, those of long ago. I am God and there is no other. I am God, there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say, my purpose will stand and I will do all that I please. My purpose will stand. So God is saying, when I declare it, when I say it, it will come to pass. It doesn't matter the intervening time. It doesn't matter the intervening situation. It doesn't matter the intervening challenges. When I declare my purpose, it shall be done. Hallelujah! So he says, my purpose shall stand. Regardless of the economic focus of Malawi, God says, I am God, there is no other. My purpose will stand. Regardless of governments making different decisions, God says, I am God, there is no other. My purpose will stand. Regardless of the power of the devil, regardless of witchcraft, regardless of every demonic powers, God says, I am God, there is no other. My purpose will stand. Regardless of those who threaten to destroy the whole earth, God says, I am God, and there is no other. My purpose will stand. Regardless of the catastrophes, regardless of El Nino, regardless of floods, God says, I am God, there is no other. My purpose will still stand. It will stand. Even when the medical report says differently, his purpose will stand. Even now, when other people walk away from you, his purpose will stand. Even if your life looks broken, destroyed, his purpose will stand. Even if you don't get a job in these trying moment times, his purpose will stand. Even if your children have run away from God for now, his purpose will stand. Pray them in. His purpose will stand. I am God. There is none like me. My purpose will stand. What has God declared in your life? Think through you. What has God spoken to you about? His purpose will stand. The last implication, and we'll be closing. His promises are the carriers of God's grace. There are two things that God cannot lie. There are two things that are immutable, of which it is impossible for God to lie. His promises. There are a lot of promises in the scriptures. A lot of promises in the scriptures. Those promises are the carriers of God's grace to will and to perform in your life. Hallelujah! Those promises, the promises that are in the word of God, are the carriers of God's grace. to will and to perform for you. I want you to do a search. Some of you can easily do a search by looking at the concordance, or by, if you are using a mobile device, you can do a search in the Bible. Just look at the word where it is promise, purpose, will, and link them with perform. You will be surprised what you will find. That God always performs according to what he has promised. God always performs according to what he has promised. So how do we know what he has promised? We go into the Bible. That's where we find what he has promised. First and foremost, the Bible. If I stand here and I promise you something that is not related to the Bible, put 10 question marks on it first. You didn't hear me. If I stand here and prophesy to you, and what I prophesy to you is not linked to the scriptures, put 10 question marks to it. It doesn't matter how I look like. It doesn't matter how long you've known me. It doesn't matter how faithful I have been in the past 20 years. I am not God. Sarah depended on the faithfulness of God first. First and foremost, the promises of God. The problem we have today in the church is that we are trusting the word that comes out of a prophet, out of a pastor, out of a prophet, an apostle, without linking it to the scriptures. So we have casualties in the church. We have got broken lives in the church. We have people that have been swindled in the church in the name of a prophetic utterance from a man of God. We have so many people. All they have is a briefcase. They have no church. They have no reputation. They have no background. All they have is a briefcase and some prophecies. That's all they have. And they change them a little bit. You can tell this prophecy is the same prophecy. The wording has changed only. That's all they have. When they come into your office, look at them. First and foremost, ask yourself, is what they are saying from God? The unfortunate thing is that we are so gullible. We easily get deceived. That's how we get deceived by witch doctors. Do you know that people who are educated, they can also go to witch doctors? Somehow, they think the man with the muti can do wonders much more than their education. But when you look at the person with muti, he is the last time he bathed. You don't even know whether he has got soap at the house. Then when you ask him, he says, no. That's how medicine works. Medicine does not work that way. It's because we are deceived, thinking things can work supernaturally without tying to the word of God. I repeat, we have a lot of Bible illiteracy in the church. Not you. So ask your neighbor, what book of the Bible are you reading now? Ask your neighbor. And tell them, I want you to answer me. You've been caught. Ask them again, what book of the Bible are you reading? So, you are waiting until you come and hear on Sunday next week. Today, you only study Isaiah 46, 3 verses. That food should keep you until next week. Another 3 verses. Aikona, it should not be so. It should not be so. So ask them. So to next week when we ask you, at least you should come and tell us you've read some chapters. Turn to your neighbor and tell them. Next week when we ask you, chapters.
The husband, they just do this.
Oh, hallelujah. The word of God is a sure foundation for us. Sure foundation. It's a word of God. So when you read from Romans chapter 4, the Bible says, Abraham did not stagger. It says, verse 20, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Why? And being fully persuaded that what he had promised was also able to perform. You link them together. What does God perform? He performs that which he promises. God does not perform that which he has not promised. That which he has promised, he's going to perform. When you start forcing God to do things he has never promised, you make him a liar. I'll repeat. When you insist that God performs something that he has never promised, you make him a liar. But Abraham was persuaded that this God is able to perform that which he has promised. That is the sure foundation. That's where we stand. Only on that, that what which he has promised, he will perform it. So brothers and sisters, what God has promised for you, you perform it. He says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. God says, if you wait upon me, you will renew your strength daily. You will renew your intellectual strength. You will renew your financial muscle. He says, if you wait upon me, I will accelerate you, like you shall have wings as eagles. You shall run and not faint. You shall walk and not be weary. God has promised. That's a promise you can stand on. That's a promise you can be able to say, God, you said, if I wait upon you, if I base my life upon you, you shall renew me. You shall recharge me. You shall recharge me. So I pray, if you have been waiting upon the Lord, let him recharge you according to his word. In Jesus' name. He shall renew you. Renewal comes because God has promised. So God performs that which he has promised.